From Washington, D.C. to our TV and radio audiences worldwide, I'm Kevin Cirilli.
And from New York, I'm Taylor Riggs. Welcome to Balance of Power, where the world of politics meets the world of business. And we get straight to that world of business. Joining us now on All Things Markets, Abigail Doolittle. Abigail, I think what really strikes me today is further outperformance of these small caps.
It's striking indeed. We have another record high for the Russell 2000. And you know, Taylor, it's Monday. We have encouraging news around the vaccine, and that is really giving energy and fuel to the cyclical rally. So small caps being a piece of that. So the small cap index up about 1.6%. Again, another all-time high. We also have outperformance for some of the cyclical sectors, such as the financials and energy. The KBW Bank Index is up 2.1%. On the other hand, money is coming out of this year's defense, tech. We have the NASDAQ 100 down 0.5%, and Apple's really leading the way, down 2.5%, breaking support levels. So the question is, which side is right? Now, if we go cross asset class and bring into account Haven assets on this, we have Havens trading lower. So overall, even though we do have tech trading down, it may suggest that today's tone is a bit more risk on, that this cyclical rally that we're seeing on stocks looking to the longer term around, again, encouraging signs of what the vaccine could mean for the economy, is risk on.
Well, and you talk about that cyclical trade and 10-year yield certainly getting a lift as well, and that never bodes well for technology stocks, does it?
Yeah, it tends to create a problem for valuations in some ways. And so we do have the tech sector, not just Apple. We have the tech sector really sliding, going right into Amazon, Facebook, Zoom. I think, though, Taylor, more so than having anything to do with yields or valuation, it really just has to do with the fact that these stocks are up so much on the year. They have worked very well. These companies have performed in very difficult conditions. And now, as it seems, that the other parts of the economy, if we do have the economy normalize, whatever the new normal will mean after the pandemic and through the pandemic, some of these stocks that have done so well, investors taking some money off at this point, perhaps profits, but in any case, chips coming off the table for technology. The bigger, broader question will be, can you have stocks continue to climb without tech? We don't know the answer to that yet. The range right now is holding. Let's see if that continues.
We will see, thanks to Abigail. Meanwhile, President-elect Biden's cabinet is starting to take shape. Ahead of tomorrow's official announcements, we are learning some of the key names that will lead national security efforts during the Biden administration. Joining us now with more details is Bill Ferries, who leads our national security team here at Bloomberg News. All right, Bill, Tony Blinken's his Secretary of State. Who else do we know is going to be on the national security team?
Hey, Kevin. Well, thanks. A couple other key names. Jake Sullivan, who was one of Hillary Clinton's closest aides, is expected to be named National Security Advisor. And we also believe that Linda Thomas Greenfield, who was a longtime State Department employee, almost four decades at the State Department before leaving early in President Trump's term, is likely to be nominated Ambassador to the United Nations. So there's also a lot of other names out there, but those are three key names we think are coming tomorrow.
And Bill, it's interesting that markets at least looking for guidance as to what this means really for our relationship with China, for our relationship with our allies as we think about international policy. What do we know so far about what this could mean for our relationship with China, with our allies?
Well, specifically, I think, and this is for China and for allies and really for everyone, I think a person like Tony Blinken has meetings with foreign leaders, and they will have the confidence that he speaks for the president. And that is not always the case, strangely, with Secretary of State. But I think in this case, where you have someone who worked with Joe Biden really for about two decades, he will walk in the room and be speaking for the president. That's not something we saw, for instance, with Rex Tillerson early in President Trump's term. And I think, you know, a couple priorities that Blinken is going to have. Joe Biden has said he wants from day one to get on the phone with key American allies and specifically NATO allies in particular to try to rebuild some of these alliances that the Democrats say have frayed under President Trump. And I think with China specifically, I think you're going to see a Biden administration and a Blinken Secretary of State looking to get a lot more allies on board to keep pressure in certain areas on China, so that if there is a policy, it's likely to be coordinated with allies I don't think you'll see a lot of, you won't see tariffs being announced by tweet or anything like that. I think there's going to be a more concerted effort to get allies in Southeast Asia and other major global powers involved in putting pressure where they think it's needed on China and trying to reach a deal where they think it's possible.
It'll be interesting to see if Ned Price gets back behind the podium at the State Department. Bill, I remember over the summer when I was prepping for my interview with Tony Blinken, and you and I were collaborating on questions and going back and forth. And one of the threads that emerged following that interview as it relates to how Mr. Blinken would deal with U.S.-China relations was from dealing with techno-democracies versus techno-autocracies. And that really is going to be the broader 5G shaping. And you just pointed to how this incoming State Department is going to try to get Western allies back on board. What are some of the first steps that a Secretary Blinken will have to take in order to get Europe back on the same geopolitical playbook?
Well, I think, first of all, he's going to recognize, and I'm sure he does, that the world is vastly different than it was just less than 4 years ago when the Obama-Biden administration was departing. Our relationship with China is very different. Some of the concerns about technology that existed back then are at a much higher level right now. So I think you'll see a much more coordinated effort to get a unified response on things like 5G and perhaps putting less kind of overt public pressure on allies, but working more behind the scenes to say, let's have an agreed policy here that we can all work with. There will be less kind of public berating of allies, I think, because in the end, I think a foreign policy team led by Blinken and Joe Biden is going to see that as perhaps less effective to getting to, in many cases, perhaps the same policy end.
And exactly. And even over the summer when he made a tweet about Taiwan, no doubt part of a broader strategy. Thanks to Bill Ferries, who oversees Bloomberg's national security coverage here in Washington, D.C. Now let's bring in Bloomberg contributor and Iona College political science professor Jeanne Zaino. I mean, we just heard it right there about the continuation of a rollout, so to speak, of cabinet level officials. Jeanne, I'm curious, who are you looking to see the Biden administration tap that maybe would ease some of the progressives who are calling for him to appoint some more progressive picks for the cabinet? Taylor, it looks like we're not being able to hear Jeanne Zaino. But Taylor, I'm really struck by this because earlier this morning, Taylor, I spoke with some progressives who were actually wondering when they're going to be able to get some of their more progressive picks in the cabinet.
Yeah, great point. And we're so fortunate, Kevin, that, of course, you're down there on the ground in D.C. You highlighted with Bill Ferries, of course, that great interview you had done in July with Mr. Blinken. He had some really interesting comments around China. I'd like to play that and then have you walk me through it. Take a listen.
The first thing is we have to dig out from a strategic deficit that I'm afraid President Trump has put us in, because right now, by every key metric, China's strategic position is stronger and ours is weaker as a result of the president's leadership.
So, Kevin, you know, some really interesting comments, and at least within the markets, all eyes on China, the tense relationship that we've had, the tariffs, and really how the last 4 years are now setting us up for any change. What do you make?
Well, three things. First and foremost, this is going to be a much more multilateral approach. They're going to have to get Europe back on board. Secondly, I've got my eye on Japan. I think the Japanese are really going to be at the forefront of some of the easing of the tensions, potentially, between the U.S. and China. And then finally, in the immediate after notion of President-elect Biden being sworn in, typically the North Koreans have actually tested missiles in the weeks that follow. They gave about 3 weeks to President Trump. So North Korea could be the first national security test for this incoming administration. Now I'm told by our producer that we do have Jeanne with us. So Jeanne, that's what I think. But more importantly, what do you think in terms of foreign policy and the tension that is going to be brought around the world about the changing of the approach from America with the Biden administration?
Yeah, it's good to talk to both of you. You know, I think what we're seeing with Joe Biden's so far, his picks for the White House, obviously, but and what we expect to be his picks for the cabinet beginning tomorrow in foreign policy, is an attempt to sort of return to normalcy, as he likes to say. So my view is I think we're going to see something of a sigh of relief from many of our allies who have been frustrated by some of what has occurred under the Trump administration. But I think it's going to differ depending on where you're talking about. And you just gave several examples. I think we're going to see a restoration of some of our agreements that were, you know, negotiated under the Obama administration. The Trump administration moved away from them. I think we're likely to see many of those restored, whether we're talking about, you know, climate change, whether we're talking about, you know, the Iran nuclear deal. I think we're going to see some of that restored. And we know from Blinken that he really does put a lot of focus on a relationship with allies that is much more traditional than President Trump has ever done. So that's really what I'm looking for. I would also say in terms of cabinet picks, this suggests we are going to be seeing a lot of Biden loyalists on this cabinet. If you look at his picks so far, these are people who have had a relationship with Joe Biden dating back many, many years. I think he's most comfortable with people who he can put out in the foreign policy arena. And foreign leaders and other countries know that they are speaking with the ear and the voice of the president. So I think we're going to see a lot of Biden loyalties on this cabinet.
Jeanne, on the point of improving relationships with allies to take on China, for example, is it enough? I mean, some critics have said that the rise of Trumpism in America First was because the 8 years under Obama wasn't enough. How do you think about that?
I have a real concern about it as well. And this was one of the things that I was frustrated by to a certain extent in the campaign. I never felt like I got an answer to what Joe Biden was going to do vis-a-vis China in particular, beyond restoring relations with other countries so that they could join together and push China in a certain direction, which very much seemed to me to be hearkening back to a sort of Obama approach, which, to your point, had left many people feeling underwhelmed and frustrated. So I'm not sure we got an answer from Joe Biden on that. I think I heard him asked many times by many reporters and others what he was going to do vis-a-vis China, and I never got a solid answer on that. So I think we're in a little bit of a wait-and-see attitude as to what he does that is different than what an Obama administration did vis-a-vis China, quite frankly, which wasn't particularly productive from any estimation.
Well, Jeanne, it is like we've planned this because we are getting some more headlines now as well. We want to thank, as always, our Bloomberg contributor, Jeanne Zaino. Kevin, it does look like President-elect Joe Biden has announced some key members of his foreign policy and national security team. You have Anthony Tony Blinken, as we know, Secretary of State, Alejandro Mayorkas, who's going to be the Secretary of Homeland Security, Avril Haines, the Director of National Intelligence, and Linda Thompson-Greenfield, U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, Jake Sullivan, National Security Advisor, John Kerry, Special Presidential Envoy for Climate. Lots of headlines continue to roll out. We'll have much more next. This is Bloomberg. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm Taylor Riggs in New York.
And I'm Kevin Cerulli in Washington, D.C.
And Kevin, we are getting some breaking news. Wanted to get your thoughts. All of these high-level cabinet positions coming out. You have the foreign policy, national security team, including, as we were just speaking about, Tony Blinken as Secretary of State, Secretary of Homeland Security to be Alejandro Mayorkas. And interesting that this caught your eye as well. The first sort of special envoy on climate will be John Kerry.
And someone who was a former not only Democratic Party standard bearer when he was the nominee of the party, but also, of course, a former Secretary of State. So clearly an elevated position already in the Biden administration on the issue of climate change. No doubt former Secretary Kerry and now the special envoy Kerry is going to have to really referee the Democratic Party on issues pertaining, for example, to the Green New Deal. There's a clear divide between centrist Democrats and Democratic Socialists on that issue. And he will be now at the forefront of that. Another name that caught my attention is the United Nations, the U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, and that's Linda Thompson-Greenfield. She is someone who has a long, long history in terms of bridging the public and private sectors geopolitically in Africa, as well as with the United States. And she is going to be, no doubt, a force to be reckoned with at the United Nations, which is a role over the past decade that has really become much more of a crucial role in Republican and Democratic administrations of recent years.
Well, I just have to say, I'm so glad that you are here joining us with your feet on the ground in D.C. I'm going to try to transition us here back to really in part what the markets are really caring about, Kevin, today, not only the news out of D.C., but as well as the latest developments around COVID-19 and the immunization now developed by the University of Oxford and AstraZeneca, showing as high as 90% efficacy in one of the trials, really closing in the high bar that was set by competing vaccinations, Pfizer, Moderna. One analyst, though, from SVB Leerink criticized the shot. AstraZeneca Executive VP Rue Dauber defended its effectiveness on Bloomberg earlier today.
Irrespective of the dosing, if you get vaccinated, it's clear that the vaccine is safe and has an effectiveness of 100%, irrespective of the dosing. So that's incredibly important to remember. And of course, we will have that discussion with the FDA as well.
For more, let's welcome Mara Espinal, professor of Arizona State's College of Health Solutions. She's a health and life sciences VC investor and a former pharma executive. Great to have you, professor. And I think our first question is, these are really high bars, but now the next step has to be about distribution. How do you think that the rollout of this may go? What are you looking for?
Well, first of all, there needs to be an infrastructure set up to ensure that distribution goes in an orderly way. The vaccine is clearly most critical initially for first responders and for healthcare providers so they can continue to provide care for those who are still affected by the disease. But what I think is critical is two things. One, it is highly unlikely that the vaccine will get to the ordinary American for many months. And secondly, even with highly effective vaccines, we cannot reduce our vigilance. We need to continue to aggressively test, mask, socially distance, and isolate when needed.
So to follow up on that, and I think that's an incredibly important point, when the initial vaccines go out to frontline workers and to immediate and to communities that are really, really at risk of getting COVID-19, what impact will the initial vaccinations make, if at all, in terms of returning to normal life?
Well, it will be a limited impact initially. It will literally be in those communities of high risk. But I believe that it will start to change the level of confidence that Americans have in the fact that this pandemic will indeed end. So it's terrific to have that additional confidence, but we can't believe that one, two, or three vaccines that are available is the silver bullet that cures this overnight. It will not. And even with our most effective vaccines, they will not work on 100% of people. And we don't know yet how much immunity they will provide. Will we need a second dose? Will it be more like flu than polio? Not clear yet, but still a great step forward to have the vaccines available.
How are you thinking about testing? There's lines three blocks around from our local testing sites here. There doesn't seem to be a comprehensive policy, at least for us, when we think about how to get the testing right. What do you think?
Well, that is the critical question. I look at the pandemic and our response to COVID-19 as a hub and spoke. The hub is indeed testing, fast and frequent testing. The lines around the block, the long times that it takes to get a response back are just completely unacceptable. What I believe we will see with recent authorizations by the FDA and hopefully more to come is a material increase in these antigen fast and frequent tests in the beginning of 21. I hope that will relieve the pressure that is on the system today. Our PCR tests are great, but we cannot put much more through the system and expect to get the kind of turnaround times that are relevant.
We'd love to have you back when we have more time. Mara Espinal of Arizona State, always appreciate your time. And stay with us. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio.
This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm Kevin Cirilli in Washington.
And I'm Taylor Riggs in New York, and we get right to the markets. Emma Chandra, she joins us. Emma, before we get to talk about the markets, I really want to congratulate you on your return from paternity leave. You have beautiful
children back now, Emma.
And it is such a pleasure to have you back. So I'll be
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
Through your Instagram baby photos on the next commercial break. Let's get back to the markets in the meantime. Of course, the race is clear. Those COVID vaccines may help the travel industry tremendously, but they still do need a lot of money now. United Airlines announcing a $1 billion share sale, maybe coming soon.
Yes, that's absolutely right, Taylor. We're hearing that they plan to offer some 25 million shares. That is the equivalent of an 8.7% dilution. And this is the latest in a round of cash-raising initiatives we've seen from United over the past year, raising some $22 billion since the start of the pandemic in March. What's interesting here is this is an equity offering. Before that, a lot of that cash had been raised through debt. Of course, debt requires things to collateralize. And I was speaking with the Bloomberg Intelligence analyst earlier, and they were saying that the reason we could be seeing an equity offering now is that United perhaps just seeing that they might have run out of things to collateralize. And of course, an equity offering that removes the burden of interest payments as well, Taylor.
You know, it's interesting, Emma, that a lot of these are coming without asset sales behind them or collateral, as you mentioned. Just last week, we had another instance where there were a lot of concerns with the Treasury Secretary announcing some rollback of programs from the Federal Reserve and said basically these companies don't need them. They're able to borrow fully within the public markets without some of this collateral. What are you noticing as well in this?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. We saw the similar thing happen with Carnival last week. That was a debt offering as well, massively oversubscribed. We are seeing that people are interested. They still want to kind of buy in to these offerings. And it seems to be that what we're seeing from United here really setting themselves from what could be a tough winter. We're not entirely sure when this sale would happen. But again, Bloomberg Intelligence telling us that they will be looking for a good day like we're seeing today when we're seeing a bit of enthusiasm in the market. And perhaps that's when we'll start to see the sale. We'll start to see some of these shares being sold by United, Taylor.
Well, thank you as always there, Emma Chandra, and welcome back. It is our luck to have you back with us. Stay with, because up next, Muddy Waters CEO Carson Block on how a Biden administration will change policy towards China investing. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio.
This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Bloomberg Radio. I'm Eric Schatzker. Among the many decisions facing the incoming Biden administration is how tough to get with China on trade, on security, on intellectual property, and also on fraud in U.S. capital markets. With us to discuss that, as well as his latest expose of Chinese fraud, is Carson Block, the CEO of Muddy Waters Capital. Carson, good to see you.
Thanks for having me, Eric. Good to be here.
Carson, as many people already know, you built your business on successfully shorting and calling out Chinese frauds. And last week, you accused Joy Incorporated, a Guangzhou-based company that's in the live streaming business, of being largely fake and, in your words, a near total fraud. Summarize, if you will, you know, what you mapped out in the report that you published and what you covered on your new video platform, Zeros.tv.
Sure. So Joy purportedly is a live streaming business where people tell jokes, sing, and supposedly their legions of fans just hand them money for having done that through the platform. The reality is the vast, vast, vast majority of gifters are fake, and the money is just round-tripped and recycled. So our best estimate is on the YY Live platform, which is the legacy business, that 90% of the gifting and therefore of the revenue that YY books is fake. And we found about half of the gifting by volume is actually coming from YY's own servers when the VPNs slip. We caught that. So we analyzed over 100, we collected and analyzed over 116 million transactions. We've been doing this research for more than a year. And that's how we get there. So it's really, it's an early version of this fraud that we saw with something that we reported on this year as well, GSX, which is basically just more bot farming and 80 to 90% fake as well.
Carson, it won't surprise you or perhaps others that the company dismissed your allegations. In this case, the company dismissed them as ignorance. And so did analysts we spoke to. In fact, one of the analysts said the kind of fakery you found at Joy is actually standard operating procedure in the Chinese live streaming. And as he put it, fake users, quote unquote, get the ball rolling. Is that true? What if it's true?
Oh, I just love the China investment world. The whole, you know, yeah, we know that there's some level of BS and, you know, we just don't want it to be too much BS. But what they are ignoring, okay, and this must require deliberate ignorance on their part, is we're not saying that the users are fake or the viewers are fake. We're saying that the actual contributions going through the system are fake. There are basically three categories of these, or why don't we call it two categories, one that has two subcategories. Category one, from bots. Okay, by volume, within about half of the contributions we tracked came from YY. Okay, YY is not supposed to be making contributions. You know, that is clearly fake. The other category were bots that are giving money while nobody's performing. That gets recorded by YY and rolls up into the revenue. Clearly, nobody has programmed bots to just hand out their money like it's Christmas. Okay, so all of that, the contributions flowing through the system from bots are fake, and the majority of the bot contributions come from YY itself. Category two is the performers who are supposedly raking in, and these are top performers. We're not talking about marginal people who, you know, are getting maybe a few thousand dollars a year in gift revenue. We're talking the very top performers who are reportedly receiving, you know, 8 million US a year in gifts. They are part of networks. We linked their device to other devices that are gifting, re-gifting what they receive. They're part of these networks recycling the same gifts again and again. And the only way that can make sense economically, because YY is supposed to clip 50% each time something is given, is if YY is in on it. And even if YY weren't in on it, this would all be fake and be rolling up to their revenue. But YY is clearly in on it, and we know that because contributions, about half by value volume, come from YY itself.
Excuse me, and I know there is more detail, and I encourage anybody who wants to understand the thesis to actually read your report or go to zeros.tv and see you explain it. I want to cut to the chase, though. The company is worth about $7 billion. It has a $7 billion market cap. If your thesis is correct, and I know you believe it is, what should this company be worth?
What's a fraud, you know, worth when they've been lying about everything for years? I mean, these things still, when they're allowed to trade in the U.S. even after delisting, have some value. I mean, it's a zero though. But
okay,
look, I think we can also relate this to a company that I mentioned earlier, GSX. I mean, GSX is as close as you can come to having, as an established fact, something is a fraud before it's delisted. It has been reported on by at least five different firms, including ourselves, each taking different approaches as fraud.
I'm going to jump in because I want to challenge what I know some of our viewers, people watching right now, are thinking, that every thesis you come out with is a persuasive one. Otherwise, you wouldn't make it, and you also make a strong argument. But the viewers know, and sometimes they speak up about this, Carson, that these companies don't all go to zero. They go down inevitably, almost inevitably, on the day that you announce the short position, but a lot of them go back up.
Well, if you're talking about an abject fraud like a GSX, after we reported on it, it tripled. There's clearly something wrong when a stock can, and you know, and a lot of people talk about Wirecard being a big story of 2020, its implosion. GSX's peak market cap, after at least three of us exposed it as a fraud, exceeded Wirecard's peak market cap. All right, this is not a question of people saying, I think the analysis is wrong. It's a good value. I'm going to buy it. This is a question of market technicals when it comes to GSX. When it comes to YY, look at the chart this morning. As soon as we enter into that part of the day when the volume falls off and it's really easy to push a stock around,
do you think the same thing is happening today with Nano Imaging, another stock that people may be familiar with, NNOX, the stock for no evident reason. This is another one of your short calls, is up 16%.
Yeah. I mean, we are, you know, what we're seeing is technicals and flows, small floats, options markets are driving the prices of stocks this year. Now, I want to, but I do want to address the larger point.
Well, and that's what I'm getting at, actually, which is...
If you step back and look at our track record of over 10 years, Eric, about 65% of the names that we ever shorted are down over the long term, and that's in a market that's done this on an alpha basis. And look, I get you can't buy a house with alpha, you can't eat alpha, but on an alpha basis, what we short generates generally pretty insane alpha.
Excuse
now, this year...
No, Carson, I'm jumping in only because I have to. I want to make sure we get to this question before we run out of time. You have made the case for years that these Chinese frauds are systematic, that they're part of a strategy, and that that strategy is tacitly or actively approved, if you will, or aided by the Chinese government. A new president is going to take office on January the 20th. What should the Biden administration's action plan be on Chinese frauds?
Well, okay, one truth to get out there is when Biden first takes office, the number one focus is going to be on the domestic agenda, right? I mean, COVID, economic relief.
Okay, after that then.
So the SEC and what the SEC is able to do and willing to do, I don't know. But the thing is, the SEC clearly cannot regulate these companies. I mean, when you see GSX doing this post-exposure in broad daylight, and you know, Bloomberg even dropped an article a week or two ago on one of the fund managers based in Singapore who's helping to push this up. I mean, this is China and the Chinese stock promotion, manipulation, fraud machine laughing in the face of the SEC. So if the SEC cannot regulate these companies, which they're showing they can't, we need to delist these companies, especially when we can't even, I mean, especially when China put on its books, effective as of this year, that no PRC-based company may cooperate with the SEC or any other foreign regulator without the express permission of the China Securities Regulatory Commission, which is clearly not going to be given in most situations. So if we can't regulate them, and they're ripping us off, and it's easy to find these case studies just, you know, tick by tick where they're ripping us off, we need to delist, because otherwise this is a total joke. And what's the point of the market?
That is the question. Carson, always great to see you, and thank you for spending time with me and with Bloomberg Television. Carson Block, the CEO of Muddy Waters Capital. Taylor?
Thank you, as always, there to our own Eric Schatzker. And coming up later today, we'll be speaking with Geoffrey Porges, who's the Director of Therapeutics Research at SVB Leerink, about his skepticism surrounding the safety of that AstraZeneca vaccine. It's coming up, 2 p.m. New York. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm Taylor Riggs in New York.
And I'm Kevin Cerulli in Washington, D.C. Joining us now is Senator Tina Smith, a Democrat of Minnesota. And Senator, look, I mean, you're back on Thanksgiving recess, but when you come back to work, lawmakers have to pass a continuing resolution ahead of December 11th to keep the government open. You think that's going to advance?
Well, I mean, we have a huge amount of work to do, and we need to just buckle down and get it done. We haven't passed COVID relief legislation in the Senate since way back in the spring. We have government funding bills that have to get passed. And I mean, I think I should be back in Washington right now getting those bills passed. Mitch McConnell needs to really come to the table and let's get our work done, just like we did earlier in the year when we passed strong bipartisan legislation.
And to follow up on this point, I mean, heartland states right now, so much attention has been paid to the cities mm-hmm. with COVID upticks, but heartland states right now across the country are experiencing such a dramatic increase in COVID-19 cases. Last week, Secretary Mnuchin called on Fed Chairman Powell to return some of the hundreds of millions of dollars back to Congress so that they could allocate some remaining resources. That was met with a head scratch by many of your colleagues on both sides of the aisle. I mean, what needs to be done in December to provide economic relief, not just for Wall Street, but for Main Street, as so many states have to have restrictions because of the uptick?
Well, what we're seeing in Minnesota, we're seeing all over the country, a real surge in the virus, especially in small towns and rural areas. Here in Minnesota, small retail is still open with the right kind of social distancing, but restaurants and other service-oriented businesses are all shut down. So what we need to do is come together with relief for individuals and for small businesses, and also for state and local governments and tribal governments who are, as we speak right now, trying to figure out how to put their budgets together for the coming year and looking at layoffs if they don't get some federal relief. So this is direct dollars to help people in small businesses and to keep cities and counties and states from having to lay off essential workers. I think that this is something that we ought to be able to come together with on a bipartisan basis. And it is, you know, it's urgent. Unemployment insurance, as you know, is going to be expiring at the end of the year. Student loan forbearance is going to be, you know, click off again in January. And as you said, this Main Street Lending Program Mnuchin is taking away at the end of the year, despite the good advice of Jay Powell.
Senator, you brought in Steve Mnuchin. I'm curious, he'd been long advocating a more targeted approach, at least pass the fiscal stimulus that we can agree on. Why is that wrong? Why do you want all or nothing? Why can't we at least pass something that's targeted that we can all agree on?
Well, you know, you'll never hear me say all or nothing. I believe in the art of compromise. Mm-hmm. I believe in coming together, and that is the virtue of actually accomplishing something. And that's what we did earlier in the year. So absolutely, we aren't all going to get everything we want. That's why we compromise. But you know, what's happening in the Senate right now is Mitch McConnell, basically every once in a while, he puts out a Republican bill and he says, vote on it. Never any effort to find common ground and to come together. And that is what is needed right now. And as I said, that's what we did the first part of the year to the great benefit of individuals and small businesses all across our country.
To follow up on something that we've been following throughout the hour, and that is President-elect Joe Biden announcing several key cabinet-level officials, including Tony Blinken, to be nominated as Secretary of State. Minnesota, with a crucial agriculture sector in your state that has really been at the forefront and ground zero, so to speak, of the current administration's policies with China, as well as other trade policies with Mexico and Canada. What are you going to be looking for in the incoming administration as it relates to agricultural trade?
Yeah, well, first, let me say that I'm really encouraged by this slate of nominees that the Biden transition has put forward, including Jake Sullivan, a Minnesotan who is going to be head of the National Security Council.
This is a Vikings fan, but go ahead.
You know what? Well, you know, us Vikings fans, we need something to hold on to and, you know, during these dark days. But what I wanted to say about this group is that they are trusted, they are seasoned, They are experienced, and I think that they have all the capacity to put the United States back into the forefront of leadership. I'm excited to see Senator Kerry is going to be special envoy for climate, which is a new thing, and I think will be highly respected around Minnesota and also around the country. And when it comes to agriculture in Minnesota, we have been buffeted by these trade wars and the erratic behavior of this administration, which has cost Minnesota farmers just so much in terms of the security of their markets. Now, things are looking up right now, and that's good, but I know what they're looking for is certainty. They're looking for some sort of strategy and some sort of a plan when it comes to trade relations. And so I'm very excited to see what I've seen so far from the Biden transition, the Biden-Harris transition on these nominees.
On that note, do your constituents want to see a reduction in some of those agricultural trade tariffs? Are they in favor of the Green New Deal? What do you hear?
Well, my constituents are looking for predictability and stability. And Minnesota is quite interesting because, you know, on the one hand, we have agriculture products. On the other hand, we're one of the largest manufacturers of medical devices. And Minnesota's Iron Range is the place where much of American steel is mined. So we want fair trade policy that lifts up farmers, lifts up workers, lifts up businesses. And the way in which this Trump administration has gone always to tariffs, when I don't think that that's the best solution, has been a real problem. But, you know, let me just say, I strongly supported the Trump administration's move to put tariffs on this illegal steel dumping, which was decimating Minnesota's Iron Range and manufacturing in the United States. So we needed something that wasn't just a one-size-fits-all, and I think that's what we got. I'm hopeful that the Biden administration is going to put American workers and businesses first.
Thank you, as always, for your time. Senator Tina Smith, Democrat of Minnesota. And this is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio.
This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio. I'm Kevin Cirilli in Washington.
I'm Taylor Riggs in New York. And let's get right back to some of the latest developments, Kevin, that we've gotten out on the Biden cabinet picks. Tyler Pager has been covering the transition for Bloomberg News. He joins us now. Tyler, is this mostly as we expected? Does anything stand out to you as surprising?
Yeah, I think Biden is, you know, participating in this process exactly as we imagined him to, choosing experienced officials, many of whom are quite loyal and worked for him for quite some time, to fill these top national security slots. Obviously, Biden has a lot of experience in foreign relations as the former chair of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. And so we're seeing some of those people that have worked with him then, like his pick for Secretary of State, Tony Blinken, coming back into the fold in these top slots.
You know, can I just say, Tyler Pager has been covering the Biden campaign essentially since its beginnings, Taylor Riggs, and he has done such an incredible, incredible job. And he's got it. If you want to know what's going on inside of President-elect Joe Biden's inner circle, follow Tyler Pager and every single report that comes from him, because he's been light years ahead of the competition all the way around. Tyler, I want to focus on former Secretary of State John Kerry, who's been named in this special envoy on climate. What do we know about this position and how he's former Secretary Kerry is going to have to be a political referee of sorts for the Green New Deal?
Yeah, so, you know, this is a new position that Joe Biden's creating specifically for John Kerry to fill, and it's going to be part of the National Security Council, so a very empowered position for an official who, you know, former Secretary of State, Democratic nominee for president, senator from Massachusetts. He's really going to have a wide range of capabilities to oversee the administration's response to climate change. You know, Joe Biden has said he is not supportive of the Green New Deal. And so we imagine that, you know, Kerry will follow that line. But Joe Biden has proposed a very ambitious trillion-dollar climate plan. And a key part of Kerry's portfolio is going to be, you know, instituting the regulations and the oversight of a really massive spending plan to curtail climate change.
All right, Tyler Pager, thank you so much. Get your rest this Thanksgiving, because next Thanksgiving you'll be at the White House covering the turkey pardons. Coming up, Balance of Power continues on Bloomberg Radio. In our second hour, we'll talk to former Biden aide Scott Mulhauser, plus the latest on the Trump legal challenges with Kermit Roosevelt of Penn Law. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg Television and Radio.